Hello and welcome to A Tactical History of Liverpool. In this episode, we leave behind the 1960s, as for the first time in the series, we enter a new decade. The 70s would be a difficult time for the city of Liverpool, with many dockers left unemployed due to containerisation and communities ripped apart by slum clearances. In truth, the city's economic downturn had started long before. The poor badly placed as trade moved away from the Atlantic towards Europe. A vibrant youth culture went some way to hiding this decline in the 60s, most notably through the Merseybeat scene. However, by the end of the decade, most were moving on to harder edge rock music. This was best exemplified by the Beatles. At the beginning of the 60s, they were just teenagers playing local clubs, and from there they would become the biggest musical act on the planet, choosing to leave their hometown as over 100,000 others did over the course of the decade. By 1970, they were working on solo projects though, and the band would break up at the end of the year. Liverpool Football Club had followed a similar trajectory. They had started the 60s as a middling second division club, yet Bill Shankly had dragged them to the top of the English game, winning two league titles and the club's first ever FA Cup. Come the end of the decade, Liverpool was still one of the best teams in the country. It had been nearly 4 years since they had last won a trophy, hardly a disaster, but certainly a drop from a team that had lit up the middle of the decade. We meet back up with them in February 1970. Since a loss to Manchester United we saw in episode 25, Liverpool had enjoyed mixed results in the league. They followed it up with wins over Burnley and Stoke, but then drew with West Brom and Newcastle, and lost to Nottingham Forest. This had seen them drop to 6th place, although it was partly because they were several matches behind their competition. Win just 2 of their 4 games in hand and they would return to where we left them, in 3rd. Having fallen well behind Leeds and Everton in the league, Liverpool's attention instead turned towards the FA Cup. Wins over Coventry, Wrexham and bogey team Leicester City saw them advance to the 6th round, where they would face 2nd Division Watford at Vicarage Road. Shankly made just one change to the 11 we saw in episode 25. Peter Thompson picked up an injury, and so he was replaced by Alan Evans. Evans had only just returned to the team following an attack in a Wolverhampton nightclub. While enjoying a quiet evening with his fiancée, whose father owned the club, Evans had a glass shoved in his face. "I was in the wrong place at the wrong time," he said. "The guy was on remand on bail from prison for the weekend. Had a big cut over my face and my girlfriend got cuts as well on her head. My nose got cut in half. I was lucky not to lose an eye. I had to have 70 stitches and it was painful because they wouldn't give you an anaesthetic, because if they gave you an injection to deaden the pain your face contracts, so they wouldn't stitch me up while it wasn't in a normal position. The pain was horrible while I was being sewn together. The injury set me back for a while and I moved to my parents' house in Kidderminster as I wasn't a pretty sight. I looked like a railway track on my face." Evans returned for the Leicester game, coming off a bench to score 2 goals and seal Liverpool's place in the quarterfinals. Watford, lining up in a 4-2-4 shape, sat in 19th place in the 2nd Division going into the game, only out of the relegation places on goal average. It should have been no match for what was a strong Liverpool team, only missing Tommy Smith and Thompson. Yet early on, Brian Owen and Mike Packer managed to drag Chris Lawler and Jeff Strong out of defence, forcing Ron Yates into covering, gifting Barry Endean space for a chance. And then they got another. And then another. And another.
This is Owen. Endean.
What should have been a routine win was becoming a disaster for Liverpool. Stuart Scullion was enjoying an excellent game on the right for Watford, and he was supported by Ray Lugg making runs out to the touchline, and Owen switching across from the left to join him. Overloading the right side, Watford were able to take advantage of an uncomfortable Peter Wall, who looked well out of his depth here. Ron Yates was often forced across to cover behind Wall, yet even he, Liverpool's stalwart captain, was having a tough time, missing several tackles. And these attacks kept coming, thanks in part to Liverpool constantly handing possession straight back over to Watford. With a pitch a muddy bog and Watford keen for a battle, Liverpool kept losing the ball in midfield, so they instead tried to play over the top of it, going long. They weren't set up to play this way either though. Evans was willing to chase and fight for the ball, however he wasn't exactly a battering ram forward. Ideally, he wanted the ball into feet. Liverpool were attempting to play quite a fluid front line, with Evans pulling wide, opening up space in the centre for Bobby Graham to move into, while Ian Callaghan would also switch sides, moving across to the left. These movements were wasted though when the only supply they were getting were long balls forward. The Reds weren't coping much better in midfield. Whereas Watford seemed to be always nipping at their heels, they weren't having the same problems escaping Ian Ross, or Ian St. John was coming out of practically every challenge second best. They managed to make it to half-time without conceding, but Watford could have easily had several already. 18 minutes into the second half, however, Watford finally took the lead. Emlyn Hughes giving the ball away cheaply allowed Watford to break, once again forcing Yates into coming across the cover, conceding a throw-in. Scullion and Lugg exchanged passes before Lugg nutmegged Wall and crossed to Endean, making a run into the box, taking advantage of Strong's lack of awareness to get to the ball first and head home. Now in need of a goal, Shankly reacted by moving Strong into midfield, with Ross replacing him at centre-back. Hughes was also encouraged to push forward into attack, with Liverpool looking to flood the box for crosses. It wasn't exactly a great showcase of their creativity, and if anything, Watford remained the greater threat. Liverpool players forced into cynical fouls and even a handball to hold their attacks. Liverpool would get one last break forward in injury time, Hughes crossing to Strong.
And Hughes, all over the top by Jeff Strong.
Just to rub salt in the wound, Watford would manage another superior chance themselves at the death. Nevertheless, Endean's goal was enough to confirm Watford's place in the semi-finals for the first time in their history. Not only had Liverpool lost to what should have been a vastly inferior side, but they had thoroughly deserved to. With better finishing, Watford could have had 4 or 5. This was the final straw for Shankly. After Watford, I knew I had to do my job and change the team, he said. I had a duty to perform for myself, my family, Liverpool Football Club and the supporters. It had to be done, and if I didn't do it, I was shirking my obligations. The first team at Liverpool was lauded as the greatest. They were the fellows who made Liverpool Football Club what it is today, but the show had to go on. Having achieved so much success in the mid-60s, Shankly believed he could keep that team together for longer, believing a player's peak was between 28 and 33 years old. I thought some of them would have gone on longer than they did because of their experience, he recalled. Maybe the success they had shortened their careers. They had won the league, the FA Cup and the league again, and they had been in Europe so often. They had played everybody and had done most things. Perhaps they were no longer hungry enough. Despite Shankly's tough guy persona, styling himself after James Cagney, he was actually a softie at heart, according to Bob Paisley. He didn't like to upset players that had done well for him.
And he was, you know, his bark was worse than his bite. He was a bit soft underneath. I mean, it's hard to turn, if you're trying to get rid of somebody, it's not easy, is it?
He wasn't ruthless because he couldn't face it. You know, ruthless man would just have made the decision, say, Jeff, come on, you won't be playing weekend.
Shanks, like, loved every player, loved all the players, and he felt it more deeply than anybody, having to leave somebody out. And when it came to the time where we all have to be left out, he didn't like that part.
Shankly's own playing peak had coincided with the Second World War, and he was reluctant to rob his players of their best years, as had happened to him at Preston. Managing is a soul-destroying job, Shankly said. You have to have a stomach made of cement. His actions suggest he was already aware that the side was waning, though. The process of breaking up the side had already begun years before, with Willie Stevenson and Gordon Milne moved on, and Jerry Byrne forced into retirement by injury. Roger Hunt had just been let go, and even Ian St. John had shockingly been dropped in October.
When I got left out for the first time up at Newcastle, he came in the dressing room. I was out leaving the tickets, you see, the usual thing, and he said, there's a team, and he put the team down and did a runner out the door, you see. So I found out from the press lads, I'm standing in it, you know, foyer there having a chat, and Jackie Milburn says, got the team sheet, and he went, yeah man, he says, you're not playing here. And I went, what? That's like, it was a, you know, the first time in your career you'd be left out. You went, what? Stormed into the dressing room, of course, no Shanks, gone. So Ruben and Bob, now come on, you know, calm down, just, you know, you get the jersey on the sub. Roger Hunt was there. Roger wasn't even playing, like, you know, so he's 13. There's only one sub there, so Roger's 13th man. So I, like, raging at this. And then the boss came in with about 10 minutes to go, you know, come on, lads, bum, 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 and off we went. Now, I said to him after, why didn't you tell me? He said, you weren't there, he said.
And I mean, it's difficult to take. Had he done the thing right, in my eyes, by taking me aside and talking to me, saying, look, you know, we've got to move forward and whatever, you know, and we've had great 10 years, but I'm looking now, Bill, you would have had to go along with it, wouldn't you? You'd need to be some sort of guy to say, I want to be in your team. So had he done that, but he couldn't face it. And, you know, then when I had a conversation with him on the Monday, he said, well, you weren't in the dressing room. I said, we're not talking about in the dressing room. I said, why did you not do it on the Friday night or a Saturday morning before we got to the ground or anything, you know? So he then just blamed me for not being in the dressing room. And that was me, I was away.
A loss and a draw in his absence saw St. John reinstated, although the murmurs weren't going that way. Everyone said the team was getting too old, and of course Ian was the one mentioned most in that respect, said Bobby Graham in an autumn interview. We just laugh about it. We're always saying, hey Ian, here's your pension book. That's how we look at it. But Watford debacle proved Shankly hadn't gone far enough though. It was time for him to bite the bullet.
That I decided after the match, that was it. I had to break them up and start again.
For the visit from Derby County a week later, he made four changes. Out went Tommy Lawrence, Ron Yates, Ian St John and Ian Ross. Yates would soon return, playing on for another year, albeit mainly at left back as Larry Lloyd replaced him in the middle. As it was the end of the road for Lawrence in St John. Lawrence would play just one more game for the first team, and St John too. The period after Watford was the busiest of Jeff Twentyman's career, as he scoured the country looking for replacements in Liverpool's rebuild, while Tom Saunders became youth development officer, in charge of Liverpool's next generation. The experience also hardened Shankly. The 60s team disappointed me in one sense, he said. I felt they should have gone on longer, and they should have won more. I don't want the same mistakes to happen this time. Whereas in the 60s he had rarely berated the team, now it's 90% rollickings according to Brian Hall. He had to drive us on, and everything we did wrong, we had to be reminded of that. He rarely complimented us, but that was the way he was. He wanted perfection. Phil Chisnell, who left the club in 1967, said, I don't think he was ruthless. I don't think players lived in fear of him. This contrasted with Steve Highway's recollection, having joined in 1970. We were all frightened to death of Bill Shankly, and a lot of people tend to forget that. A lot of people see Shanks as being amusing and warm, and he was all those things, but I guarantee 99% of the players were frightened to death of him because he had that very abrasive, aggressive side to him as well. Shankly wasn't about to let his new team rest on their laurels as their predecessors had. These changes wouldn't immediately improve the team though. They would finish the 1969-70 season in 5th place, 15 points behind local rivals Everton as the Blues won the league. The start of the 70s was to be a period of transition for Liverpool. If you enjoyed this video, please like and subscribe to support the channel. You can get updates on what I'm doing by following on Twitter and Facebook, links are in the description, but most importantly by supporting Holding Midfield on Patreon. Without financial support, I can't justify the time it goes into making these videos to keep the channel alive while also receiving access to premium content. Thanks for watching.